Let me run through some notices. I think everyone that needs to know about Impact and Little Lambs was here this morning. And likewise for Explorers. The one thing that I would point out is that rather than meeting here on Wednesday at 7 o'clock, we've got a special prayer meeting with Tower Valley. That's at 7:30. 7:30 in the Mercure Hotel in Llansamlet. So I'll put the details for that on our WhatsApp group, and it'll be in the bulletin as well. They've got a special missionary meeting about the Slavic Gospel Association. So I've heard them before, and the work they do is really remarkable and incredibly encouraging to hear. So I would really encourage you to come to that if you can. That's on Wednesday night at 7:30 in the Mercure Hotel. So please do make every effort to come to that if you can. And then next Sunday we're meeting 10:30 in the morning. We'll be looking at Luke, and at 6 o'clock we'll be starting a new series in the Book of Ruth. So please do come along to that and pray for those meetings as well. Let me read to you from 2 Corinthians 4. 2 Corinthians 4, for what we proclaim is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, with ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. We're going to sing our first song this evening. We're going to sing, Hear the Call of the Kingdom. So, when the music begins, let's stand together. Our reading this evening comes from Genesis 10 all the way up to chapter 11 and verse 9. So Genesis 10, there's lots of difficult names in Genesis 10. I was very tempted to give it to someone else to read, but You'll have to bear with my pronunciation. And then we'll go into 11 and verse 9. And we'll be focusing mainly this evening on those first 9 verses in Genesis 11. These are the generations of the sons of Noah: Shem, Ham, and Japheth, sons who were born to them after the flood. The sons of Japheth: Gomer, Magog, Madai, Javan, Tubal, Meshech, and Tiras. The sons of Gomer: Ashkenaz, and Riphath, and Togarma. The sons of Javan: Elisha, Tarshish, Kittim, and Dodanim. From these the coastland peoples spread in their lands, each with his own language, by their clans in their nations. The sons of Ham: Cush, Egypt, Put, and Canaan. The sons of Cush: Seba, Havilah, Sabta, Rama, and Sabdica. The sons of Rama: Sheba and Dedan. Cush fathered Nimrod. He was the first on earth to be a mighty man. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Therefore it is said, like Nimrod, a mighty hunter before the Lord. The beginning of his kingdom was Babel, Erech, Akkad, and Calneh in the land of Shinar. From that land he went into Assyria and built Nineveh, Rehoboth, Calah, and Rezin, between Nineveh and Calah, that is the great city. Egypt fathered Ludim, Anamim, Lehabim, Naphtuhim, Pathrusim, Caslahim, from whom the Philistines came, and Kaphtorim. Canaan fathered Sidon, his firstborn, and Heth, and the Jebusites, the Amorites, the Girgashites, the Hivites, the Arkites, the Sinites, the Arvadites, the Zemarites, and the Hamathites. Afterwards the clan of the Canaanites dispersed, and the territory of the Canaanites extended from Sidon in the direction of Gerar as far as Gaza, and in the direction of Sodom, Gomorrah, Admah, and Zeboim, as far as Lasha. These are the sons of Ham, by their clans, their languages, their lands, and their nations. To Shem also, the father of all the children of Eber, the elder brother of Japheth, children were born. The sons of Shem: Elam, Ashur, Arphaxad, Lud, and Aram. The sons of Aram: Uz, Hul, Gether, and Mash. Arphaxad fathered Shelah, and Shelah fathered Eber. To Eber were born 2 sons. The name of the one was Peleg, for in the days the earth was divided, and his brother's name was Joktan. Joktan fathered Almadad, Sheleph, Hazarmaveth, Jera, Hadoram, Uzal, Dikla, Obal, Abimael, Sheba, Ophir, and Havilah, and Jobab. All these were the sons of Joktan. The territory in which they lived extended from Mesha in the direction of Shephar to the hill country of the east. These are the sons of Shem, by their clans, their languages, their lands, and their nations. These are the clans of the sons of Noah, according to their genealogies, in their nations. And from these, the nations spread abroad on the earth after the flood. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as people migrated from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said to one another, "Come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly." They had brick for stone and bitumen for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens. And let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth." And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of man had built. And the Lord said, "Behold, they are one people, and they have all one language, and this is only the beginning of what they will do. And nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and there confuse their language, so that they may not understand one another's speech." So the Lord dispersed them from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth. And from there the Lord dispersed them over the face of all the earth. Amen. Now let's pray together, shall we? Father in heaven, we come before you now asking for your help in understanding your word. We sometimes read certain passages and we do not know why you have allowed these things to be preserved. And yet in your infinite glory and in your infinite wisdom, these things will do us much good as we look at them and as we study them. Lord, we pray, therefore, that tonight will not be an intellectual exercise of finding some interesting facts out, Lord, but this would be a time for us to be conformed to your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. That is our aim. Every time we meet here, we hope to be become more like the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, through the aid of the Holy Spirit. And so, Lord, that is our prayer once again this evening. We ask of you to help us. If there are blind spots that we cannot see in our lives, where we are struggling with pride, if we are struggling with our ambitions, whatever it might be, Lord, if we are struggling with any aspect of sin that is causing us to grow further away from you, Lord, we pray that you would speak to us tonight, Lord. We pray for your help in these things. Lord, we thank you for the way in which we were able to meet this morning. It was an encouragement to be with your people. And for those who did not know you there this morning, we pray that they would know the Lord Jesus for themselves. We thank you for the words Mary penned and the way in which she showed her awe and wonder of her Savior, even before he had been physically born in front of her. Lord, we thank you for her servant heart. And Lord, we pray that you would help us to serve the Lord Jesus Christ in all that we do. And we thank you for the time of fellowship that we had in Coed Gwilym. And Lord, we pray that we as a church would not just be people who meet together for an hour in the morning, an hour in the evening on a Sunday, but Lord, that our whole lives would be in service to you and to one another. We pray that we would build one another up, that we would encourage one another, that we would be sharpening one another, that we would be challenging one another. Lord, we need your help in all of this. We cannot do these things by our own strength. We are prone to failure, Lord. We give up so easily, and so we ask for your help this evening. We pray that we would be a church that would be built on strong foundations, that we would be built on the rock that is the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray that we would hide ourselves in him. Lord, be with those who are children, who are young here this evening, and within our church. We pray that they would know the Lord Jesus while they are still young. We pray that they would not fall on the fact that their parents are Christians, Lord, but that they would see that they need the Lord Jesus for themselves. We pray for those who have loved ones who aren't believers. We pray that you would save them and bring them to yourselves. We pray for the older believers that are with us tonight. Would you help them in these difficult, changing years of life, Lord? We pray that you would draw near to them. Would you give them comfort and courage in facing these difficult final years, and help them to cling on to their Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray that all of us here this evening would be longing to be with the Lord Jesus. Help us not to cling to the things of this world, the comforts that and passions that this world has to offer, but we pray that we would long to be with our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. It is far better that we are with him. So Lord, we pray that you would come quickly, and we pray that we would all be ready for that day to come. O Lord, in your precious name we pray. Amen. We're going to sing once again before we come to this passage in Genesis 11. We're going to sing, "You're the Word of God the Father." Mankind is forever been pushing the boundaries, trying to rise higher, trying to better previous generations, trying to create some sort of legacy so that future generations will look back with awe and wonder. And as we come to a close in this series in the book of Genesis, I think there's been 15 sermons. Yes, there's been 15 sermons in this series looking at this what people call the primeval time period, before the time of Abraham, really, Genesis 1 to 11. We will see one of the very first occasions where this happened. We see the folly of man and God's overruling sovereignty. And I want us to start with a question that we've considered in weeks gone by. What did God want from the people? Especially after the flood, what did he want? After this truly cataclysmic event, what did God envision for those who had survived? And you can see it there in Genesis 9 and verse 1. And God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth." God's great desire is for them to, of course, to serve him and obey him, but also to go out, to explore this wide world that he had made. And it looks like when we read chapter 10 together that they had done exactly that. We saw Shem's descendants go out into what we call the Middle East today, the Gulf region of Israel and Palestine and Iran and Iraq and Jordan. Shem's descendants are the ones to whom the promise would come through. Look at verse 6 of chapter 10. We see Ham's descendants. Mainly they go into Africa. You see that his sons are called Egypt. And Cush, which is another name for Ethiopia. He's got another son called Put, which is another word for Libya. And of course Canaan, which would one day be given to Shem's descendants. And there's also Japheth. They are the ones who go into parts of Europe and Turkey and Greece. And Russia, Magog is another word for Russia, and Javan is the word for Greece. You see, all of mankind come from these three brothers. And we have a summary, don't we, there in verse 32 of chapter 10. These are the clans of the sons of Noah, according to their genealogies, in their nations. And from these, the nations spread abroad on the earth after the flood. But there's a twist. Just how sometimes we see in modern film or in literature, we see events taken out of sequence. It turns out that chapter 11 is how the events of chapter 10 came about. Chapter 10 gives us a geographical and linguistic description, while chapter 11 is providing a theological explanation of how this all happened. You see, God had told them to disperse, but the people didn't want to spread out. They didn't want to fill the earth. They weren't obedient to God. And then we read these words there in chapter 11. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words. We begin to realize that chapter 11 is coming before chapter 10 in terms of chronology. And as people migrated from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said to one another, come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone and bitumen for mortar. Then they said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth. And the tension of this story builds and it builds. And every detail we're given adds to this sense of foreboding. Now the whole earth had one language, it says. The same words. And you think, okay, fantastic. Everyone can understand one another and communicate in a perfect way. What could possibly go wrong? The next bit tells us they find a plain. Not an aeroplane, a plain of land. A flat, good piece of land in the land of Shinar. Ah, we think, maybe they're going to use this land to honor God. And then we read that they make bricks. Not exactly cutting-edge technology for us to be reading about in the 21st century, but imagine the possibilities when they first discovered bricks. Maybe they'll use these bricks, you might think, to make an altar like we saw Noah make. Or maybe they'll make a temple dedicated to the Lord. But then comes the motive. Here come the aspirations here in verse 4. Come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens. And let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth. You see, these people have lofty ambitions. They want to reach the heavens themselves. They want to become gods by reaching the gods. And what we soon see is that they have two particular idols spurring them on, driving them on. And these desires, I think, are as prevalent today as they were 4,000 years ago. And the two motivations that I want to focus on in particular is to have security and to have status. To have security and to have status. The first thing I want to look at is security. The people didn't want to disperse. There's safety in numbers. There's comfort in doing the same thing as everyone else. Historians think that the type of building that they were making would have been what's called a ziggurat, this sort of tiered building, not dissimilar to a pyramid. And archaeologists have found at least 30 of these structures in the Mesopotamian area. And you could just imagine it, can't you? There's a buzz in the city. Architects are walking around with important pieces of parchment in their hands, and everyone is trying to catch a glimpse of these plans. There's a huge plot of land on this plain in Shinar that no one's been allowed to build on for the last year. And the call goes out. There's going to be a tower like the world has never seen before. we know, don't we, that our forefathers, you can hear the people muttering to themselves, they were told to disperse and go out into the world, to be fruitful and to multiply. But the land seems to be so fruitful here. And all our friends are here too. And they need all hands on deck. They need everyone they can. They need people on site. And they need people on the kiln making bricks, don't they? No one wants to feel left out. Everyone wants a part to play in this great project. And the conversations go forth, back and forth in the town square. What are you doing for the project? In what way are you helping? And soon anyone who isn't involved in this great tower feels a little bit left out, like a spare part, like they aren't doing their bit. And that can be the same for us, can't it? We feel a great deal of security in doing what everyone else is doing. Are we talking about the same things as our colleagues in work? Are we watching the same things as our friends at school? Are we dressing in the same way? Are we raising our children in the same way? Are we voting in the same way? Yet the call for the Christian is not to find safety in numbers. Romans 12 tells us, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Or think of what Peter tells the persecuted church in his first letter. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. You see, you are called to be different. And think of how the tower would have given the people a sense of physical safety. Imagine living in the shadow of this tall structure. You would feel so emboldened, wouldn't you? There's no other city. There's no other group quite like us, is there? They're not going to mess with us. We're unstoppable. And we see that, don't we, on a large scale with nation states as they build more destructive weapons and they conscript soldiers to make bigger armies. We see it in our own personal lives. We build taller walls around our houses. We put burglar alarms up. We put life insurance up. We have a safer car. And we know, though, that even the fiercest armies can fall and even the healthiest, safest individual can fall ill and can be struck down unexpectedly. You see, we cannot find our security in our own strength. Or perhaps think of another security that we have. The security that we find in doing something, in routine, in having some sort of order and purpose in life. And that's not a slight on having purpose and ambition and routine. But there's a danger, isn't there, in finding a sense of security from making ourselves so busy that we're not thinking about eternity, what we're truly supposed to be living for, being so distracted with projects and to-do lists that we have no time for the Lord. And I'm sure that was a part of the appeal for some of those who were involved in building this tower. That they had something to do, that they had goals, they had aims, and they had ambition. We can be the same too, can't we? We're busier than we've ever been before. We're more connected. We've got more devices in our pockets and on our wrists. We're more aware with what is going on in not just our locality, but all over the world. But we're not called to be busy and to be successful or ambitious. God's great desire is for us to be faithful and to be obedient. Those are his aims for our lives. The other things that follow are bonuses. For us to follow him, for us to find joy in our serving of him is the important thing. So that's the first thing that we see the people building this tower were looking for. They were looking for security. And that comes in many forms. But the other thing that we see that they were clearly after is also in verse 4. They were looking for status. A great sense of why the people did this was in order to make a name for themselves. to find fame, to etch their name in history. And they certainly would be remembered for years to come. We're still talking about this group of people 4,000 years on. But for all the wrong reasons. And there's a clue in the text that we are about to see the people going in another direction to God's will. I wonder if you spotted it. There's a pattern throughout the book of Genesis that to head eastward is to be away from God's promise and his presence. Come with me in your Bibles. Look at Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 24. This is after Adam and Eve have fallen and they've eaten from the tree. And what do we read in verse 24? He drove out the man, and at the east of the Garden of Eden, he placed the cherubim and a flaming sword that turned every way to guard the way to the tree of life. So they are away from God. They've gone east. Go to the next chapter, Genesis 4 and verse 16. Cain has, at this point, murdered his brother, the first murder the world has ever seen. And we see in verse 16, then Cain went away from the presence of the Lord and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. In later on, I just listened to this reference, but it's in when Lot and Abraham, later on in Genesis, when they're deciding where to go, Lot chose for himself all the Jordan Valley, and Lot journeyed east. Thus they separated from each other. Abraham settled in the land of Canaan, while Lot settled among the cities of the valley and moved his tent as far as Sodom. Now the men of Sodom were wicked, great sinners against the Lord. Now, what I'm not saying this evening, I'm not making this point that we as people living in the West today have to pat ourselves on the back. And if you live in Clydach rather than Cardiff, then you've done well. And if you're living in Cardiff rather than Norwich, say, then you can be pleased with yourself too. That's not the pattern that is still here today. But there is a pattern that Moses is drawing our attention to in order to give those who are listening to this account that the people are going away from the presence of the Lord. And the people here, rather than desiring to do what God wanted, rather than obeying him, they wanted human praise. And so they head east. And we see there that they want to make a name for themselves. Humanity has a great desire to make a name for themselves. We've been called as Christians to find our joy and our identity in the Lord, in what the Lord Jesus has achieved. And yet there's this desire to find it elsewhere. It should be enough, shouldn't it, to know that our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And yet, we want our names in lights. We want our names on Wikipedia entries and on the lips of others and on social media and wherever else that we might find our names. That is where we want it. And to get that attention that we crave, we forever try and push the boundaries of what is possible in order to achieve it. Whether that be the skyscrapers and the megastructures that dominate the skylines of the world's biggest cities. Think of the Burj Khalifa, the tallest building in the world in Dubai, standing at 828 meters tall. It reflects the ambition, doesn't it, to reach unprecedented heights. And it's going to be the tallest building until the Jeddah Tower, which is under construction in Saudi Arabia, is built, which is going to be another 200 meters taller, over a kilometer in height. It is going to be huge. Or think of space exploration, efforts to make it to the moon in the 60s, or those efforts by NASA and other organizations to make it to Mars. Elon Musk, the world's richest man, every once in a while, whether he's being silly or not, has the ambition to not only reach another planet, but to establish a human presence there. This is what he said. It's been now half a century since humans were last on the moon. That's too long. We need to get back there and have a permanent base on the moon. We need a permanent occupied base on the moon and then build a city on Mars to become a spacefaring civilization. We need to be a multi-planet species. How about the Hadron Collider in Switzerland? It doesn't come up so much anymore in the news, but remember about 10 years ago when we kept hearing these updates about this powerful particle accelerator. Just represents, doesn't it, human curiosity to understand the nature of the universe. Well, think about more recently artificial intelligence and technology and these blurring of the lines between human and technology. These are the ones on the grand scale, aren't they? These are the ones that make it to the news. But we see it in our own lives too, don't we? The ways in which we try to be seen by others. We are desperate for the praise and the respect of other people. We want to be remembered. We want to be recognized. We want our voice to be heard. But human achievements are ultimately minuscule in comparison to the God of the universe. No matter how high the tower is, God has to descend in order to see it. The writer uses language that highlights this. The Bible sometimes uses humor in order to draw something out. And look at verse 5 with me. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of man had built. Yes, of course, God can see everything. He doesn't need to come down. But Moses, the writer here, is emphasizing how microscopic this endeavor is. Oh, is that what you're doing? You're building some gateway to the heavens in order to come up to me? And yet I have to come all the way down here just to try and see it. I think it is that. Oh, that's it, is it? And yet, at the very same time, in this discussion among the Trinity, it shows us that he is still taking their actions incredibly seriously. Look at verse 6. The Lord said, behold, they are one people, and they have all one language, and this is only the beginning of what they will do. And nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. You see, despite the puniness of their tower in comparison to God, the Lord knows that it could prove to be a threat to his people and his promised line if it carries on like this way. And that is why God does what he does there in verse 7. Come. Let us go down there. He speaks in the Trinity. And there confuse their language so that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord dispersed them from over the face of all the earth and they left off building the city. If you've ever tried to communicate with someone through a language barrier, you'll know how quickly it can stop any sort of progress. Last year, when we were still living in Cardiff, a car was parked in front of our drive, which was very annoying, and I soon realized that this car had broken down right outside our house. And I went outside with my incredibly limited knowledge of cars to see if I could do anything. Little did I know that my inability to know a drive shaft from an alternator to a brake pad was not going to be the issue here. You see, the man who had broken down was a poor Vietnamese chap with no English at all. So what I did was I tried to call the AA on his behalf, but all the basic information that they needed was impossible to relay back to him, even when I was trying to say it very slowly and very loudly. Name, I need your name. Where do you live? Where do you live? You see, he had no English and I had no Vietnamese, and that was a real struggle. And by the end, I was the one having the breakdown rather than him. And he managed to call a friend who spoke the same language as him. But it was a real eye-opener to see how vital language is for communication. Things can only get done if we can put across what we want and what we need. And that is what has happened here. This is how God shows his sovereignty and his power. In Genesis 11, the people of this area were moving at such a pace because they were all on the same page and were able to communicate with ease, and therefore God confused their language. And though God acted in this way in order that this project would be hindered, this was not a curse. Languages are not a product of the fall. It's God's grace, and has always been his plan, that we have languages and different countries and nations and cultures. I was reading what John Piper had to say on this very passage, and it was very helpful. He makes a really astute point. He says, God's division of the world into different language hinders the rise of a global, monolithic, anti-Christian state that would have the power to simply wipe out all Christians. We often think that the diversity of languages and cultures and people is a hindrance to evangelizing to the whole world. But that's not how God sees it. God is more concerned about the dangers of human uniformity than he is about diversity. We humans are far too evil to be allowed to unite in one language or one government. The gospel of the glory of Christ spreads better and flourishes more because of 6,000 languages, not just in spite of it. And it's true, isn't it? God's sovereignty and his grace has allowed for many languages and many cultures. And yet only one faith, one religion, transcends these. It's a wonderful testimony of the authenticity of the one true faith, Christianity. You see, Islam and Hinduism and Buddhism can only truly live, can only truly thrive in these specific cultures and lands where they started and where the governments and the laws of the land are in favor of them. If you want to worship Allah, you have to worship him in Arabic. He is a dumb God who doesn't understand any other language apart from Arabic. And if you want to read his holy book, you can only read it in that language. Some people say that at Pentecost, God reversed the Tower of Babel. But that is exactly what he didn't do. You see, at Pentecost, God underlined the diversity that he introduced at Babel. Everyone in the crowd was able to understand what was being said in their own language. The Holy Spirit was making it possible for the good news of the gospel to be understood in many languages at once. God didn't force this conformity on his followers by making them all hear his messages in one language. He encourages diversity by allowing them to hear in their own language. That is why Christianity can survive any language, any government, any cultural norm, any time period. That's why you can find Christians in every country and every continent. Just think of the Roman Empire and the early church, both of these around in the first century. But if you were to ask someone in the first century which one of these is going to end in 300 years' time, you probably would have guessed the church. But as Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed that a man took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all seeds, but when it is grown, it is larger than all the garden plants and becomes a tree so that the birds of the air come to rest in its branches. As we reflect on what has happened in the election on Thursday, perhaps, we can take great comfort that even the most powerful, even the most impressive nations cannot defy God and survive. It's a year of political change in the whole world. It's here and in France and in India and the US. There are 60 elections taking place at least this year. But it's God who decides who thrives, who survives. Unless the Lord builds, those who build it labor in vain. It is those who seem the most impressive in human terms that are most likely to fall. If God is with us, then we will surely be safe and have the status better. If God is with us, then we will surely be safe and we'll have the security and we'll have the status better than any other master architect or space traveler or king. You see, it's not for us to make a name for ourselves. That is not what we've been called to do as believers. There's a sharp contrast with the actions of those of Babel and a particular individual in the next chapter of Genesis. Genesis 12, the Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you, and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing." If you're looking for status and for security, don't look for it in this world. Look for it in the Lord Jesus. Look for it in serving him, in seeking his kingdom first, and then everything else shall be added to you. Building a tower to try and reach God. And that's what everyone is really trying to do. Trying to reach God with their own accomplishments, with their own will, with their own morality. There's no point. God is the one who didn't wait for us to reach him, because we never will. But he's the one that descended to our level, who took on flesh, who was incarnated in order that we might know God himself. John 1, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only God who is at the Father's side. He has made him known." So in Christ alone can we find the security and the status that we crave. Not fleeting security, not empty praise, but everlasting security. Knowing that we have eternal life and that we will never perish and no one will snatch us out of the Lord's hand. Don't chase the kudos of your contemporaries, but hear the words that we all long to hear from our Father in heaven. "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master." I want to finish by reading some verses from Revelation 7. Words which show us that Babel was an act of God achieving his divine purposes. Despite the will of the people to remain uniform, God saw the diversification of the world as a beautiful gift rather than a curse forever. Languages, cultures, and nations are good things which highlight the broadness of God's grace. Revelation 7 and verse 9. "After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and people and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb.' And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and worshipped God, saying, 'Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen.'" We're going to finish by singing a wonderful old song with some tricky old-fashioned words. I'll just walk through some of them before we sing them so that we can enjoy the richness of this hymn. It talks about angels prostrate fall. So these are heavenly creatures falling on their faces. It talks about bringing forth the royal diadem. What's a diadem? Well, it's a type of crown. And this song is about casting our crowns before the Lord and crowning him the Lord of all. And it speaks of when we're in heaven, when we're worshipping the Lord. The second verse speaks not only of those... Can we see the second verse? Yeah, that was it, sorry. No, the one before that. Yeah, so they extol the stem of Jesse's rod. So this is a referring to a prophecy that was made in Isaiah of one that would come out from the house of David, the rod of Jesse. So that's what that is talking about. The wormwood and the gall, which is in the next verse, is speaking about the pain and the affliction that a Christian may know. When it talks about every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial ball is just a way of saying the world. And when on the last verse, when it talks about a yonder sacred throng, this just yonder means a distant place, sacred means heavenly, and a throng is just a crowd of people. We don't use that word anymore, but it pictures a group of people in glory falling at the feet of Jesus. And we all join in with those words, in glory. Crown him, crown him, crown him. So let's stand and let's sing these wonderful words together. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall.
Let angels prostrate fall before the royal diadem and crown him, 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 crown him,
pray together.
Lord, we thank you that you are King of all. We thank you that you are the King of kings, and we thank you that we have been able to worship you in song and in word this evening. We pray that we would not forget these things, that we would live out these truths that we have just looked at, and that you would bless us as we go our separate ways this evening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.